Hi there. Welcome to the 213th meeting of the New York Linux Users Group. This is the latest of our regular monthly meetings. Tonight, we have Charles Strahan, who will be giving us his introduction to NixOS talk. I'd like to say how much we appreciate our space sponsor, Bloomberg, for providing us with this space. And thank you to everyone who's come out tonight for taking the opportunity. Charles Strahan started contributing to NixOS in early 2014 and has since become a committer on the project. He's the current maintainer of the Ruby Rails application packaging infrastructure and also maintains roughly 80 other individual packages. He currently resides in Brooklyn, New York, works remotely for Decipher Technology Studios, and tinkers with Haskell in his free time. Now please welcome Charles Strahan giving us an introduction to NixOS.
All right, well, first I'd like to thank you all for having me. It's a pleasure to be able to talk about NixOS, and I hope that there's something that you'll see in it that you think might make your life just a little bit better. So this is a talk on NixOS, as you know. It is a Linux distribution that is kind of set apart from the others by using a rather novel approach to package management. And there are some really interesting things that kind of fall out of that with respect to configuration management. So just to reiterate, we use a package manager called Nix. We call it a purely functional package manager. From that, we get declarative deterministic configuration management. Now you might be thinking, like, purely functional package manager, that sounds sort of almost like oxymoronic. Like, I use a package manager because I want to install stuff. That doesn't exactly sound very pure and functional. But I'll clarify that as I go. We'll kind of see what the purity and functionalness of it is. A bit about me, and to kind of give my perspective on NixOS and where I'm coming from. As was mentioned, I started, I guess, about like first quarter 2014. Originally, I had no idea about NixOS, but was looking for some work, potentially writing some Haskell. I've been spending maybe like 2 months learning it and was like, yeah, I could totally get a job doing that. And not so much, but one of the cool things that came out of that was there was somebody looking to hire in Singapore that uses both Haskell, and the other big bullet point was NixOS. And I was like, what in the world is that? So I figured they couldn't be too far off base if they're using Haskell. And I had kind of been a newly minted disgruntled Ruby developer, so I was like, yeah, it's got to be great, whatever it is. So I set on a mission to learn and contribute to NixOS, and then eventually just totally forgot about the job, and now here I am. it's kind of become my life to some degree. So one of the very first things I packaged was Apache Mesos, and then having the Rails background, despite not really liking it, I figured with all the utility that I got out of NixOS, I figured I ought to be able to bring more people to the operating system, the distribution. And I think one of the things that is really important is that you support the different development environments that people are using. And so the Rails story kind of started out not that great. And now it's pretty good. We have a way to say, I don't know, who here uses Rails or Ruby in production? See, a handful of people here. So when I say gem file, you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? Yeah, some heads nodding. All right, so we can take a gem file, which is like, for people who don't do Ruby or Rails, is like metadata about what Ruby packages, what Ruby libraries do you use, what versions potentially, that kind of thing. We can run that through a program that will spit out a Nix expression that fully locks down exactly what the dependencies are that you need for your Rails application. And then the idea is that you have a fully deterministic way to then deploy your Rails application. You don't have to worry about any of that, like, oh, well, it kind of works on my machine, and I guess when I use Capistrano and do some SSH stuff, maybe it'll work, I don't know. So that's pretty cool. Another thing that I put a lot of effort into is getting GHCJS, which is the sort of JavaScript front end for, or back end, excuse me, for GHC, which is the Glasgow Haskell compiler. So you can actually write Haskell programs and spit out JavaScript. I helped get that packaged. Also extracted fan networking from Ubuntu. That's been kind of interesting. And then there are like 80 other miscellaneous packages that have my name attached to it. So with that out of the way, I'd like to talk about why. Why am I here to talk about NixOS? I could tell you that the mere technical nature of NixOS is really interesting, and you should dabble with it just for your own sort of edification. But we all have jobs and potentially families or spouses, friends, that kind of thing, and it's kind of nice to get away from the computer. So my idea of like the one takeaway from this talk should be why you want to use NixOS, and I think the answer is that you'll have a lot more time for other things than putting out fires. So if I can elaborate on that, who here uses one of these things? Cool, so that's like most of the room. Something like this is not on the list? Cool, can I ask what? What's that? Docker? Oh yeah, sure. Anything else? Jenkins? All right. So these things are pretty great in sort of absolute terms anyways. I remember when I first had to deploy stuff and not knowing about any of this stuff, I was like, all right, well, I barely know Linux. I guess I'll try to like slap together some of those bash scripts, whatever that is, and have this big pile of stuff that'll drive SSH or something like that. And it's a complete nightmare. So compared to that, they're great, but I think we can do better because there are a handful of problems that are inherent with the sort of paradigm that Puppet, Chef, Ansible, and that sort of thing are working on top of, which isn't really necessarily their fault. It's just that they're built on the sort of conventional way of approaching Linux. And I think that in itself kind of doesn't provide the foundation that would be optimal. So looking at the kind of problems we have here, who has ever attempted to deploy something with their configuration management system of choice and had it totally go up in flames? Or it worked here, didn't work over there. That kind of thing, yeah. I see some smiles and some hands. So that's not fun. You spend like hours scratching your head wondering like, all right, well, it deployed to these 1,000 machines, but not these, and I don't know. How about rollback? Who here feels absolutely confident that if they were to deploy some changes, they could have all those changes perfectly reverted without any cruft or crap left around? Anybody? Kinda, yeah. What's that? Vagrant. I can kind of see that, blow it away. Kind of same thing with Docker. Now who kind of feels like that's cringeworthy, the thought of like, oh, I can roll back and it'll be totally fine. Like, is anybody like scared of the thought of, a little bit, all right, cool. yeah, so that's also no fun. If you're at like, if you're sitting at your desk at 2 a.m. trying to figure out, why something went wrong, and you're thinking, well, I'll just roll back and it doesn't happen, that's no good. It doesn't really inspire confidence. Speaking of, who here has had a pager go off and wake them up in the middle of the night? Lots of us, yeah, also not fun. So we want to avoid that. Speaking of getting into machines and trying to figure out what is going on, I guess that's kind of the last bullet point here, but if you wanted to SSH into a machine for whatever reason, generally, like you want to have everything automated so you don't have to, but say you want to poke around, look at some log files real quick, maybe kind of experiment with something. Have you ever had a scenario where you needed a tool to get your job done, but it wasn't installed on the server? Anybody? Yeah, and then for those that didn't have privileged access to install something, or for that matter, even if you did have the ability to install something, you practically couldn't because it would cause conflicts or something like that, or just generally wouldn't be safe. Like, of you guys, who's had that be a blocker to getting stuff done? Yeah, not fun at all. So the kind of last thing here is multiple package versions. Generally, you can't really have multiple versions of the same package installed. Personally, that bit me before I discovered NixOS back in like 2013. I had a little bit of a hobby project where I was wanting to use the RIAC data store, which was using like required one version of the Erlang VM. And then I also wanted to use Elixir, which is a language that compiles to the Erlang VM, which required a completely different version, like completely different major version bump. So I'm kind of stuck thinking, all right, well, what will I do? I guess I'll compile from source, but like it's gotta be something better than that. and then stuff it in its own prefix, because if you have some libraries or executables with the same name, you can't really stuff them in the same spot, they'd collide. So I think kind of boiling down those problems that I just described there, you really kind of have three things. You have a problem of mutability, the fact that the process is imperative, and you have non-determinism all kind of fighting against you. And by that, I mean, looking at the first bullet point, if you look at the file system hierarchy standard, that is the standard of kind of where you dump all of your executables, put your configuration files, that sort of thing. So it's the common suspects like user local bin, user bin, that sort of thing. For those that's an unfamiliar term. Everything kind of gets dumped more or less into the same spot. So you don't really have any sort of good way to have multiple things installed because they all kind of go in the same place. That in itself is a big problem, having what kind of amounts to a big, massive thing of global mutable state. And then from the imperative standpoint, I think generally where you have problems rolling back or even just getting a new state deployed, it usually comes down, the problems you'll have usually comes down to having some sort of line-wise modifications or you want to delete some sort of file somewhere, but it turns out something else had taken a dependency on it, that kind of thing. So you have this really sort of intertangled process by which you install and set up and configure as you go along with your configuration management. And so if you run things in a different order, you get totally different results. So to sort of draw a comparison and try to kind of work towards the sort of paradigm shift with NixOS, I would kind of like to conjure up this image here. Who recognizes what this is? Yeah, would somebody like to shout it out? Yeah, exactly, yeah, so it's a Git revision graph. So each of the, just in case there's anybody who doesn't know or somebody watching at home, the arrows pointing over to the left represent the parent commits, each one of those little blue or gray square, I guess in this case just blue, green, blue? Green squares represents a commit. So C1 has a parent commit of C0, that kind of thing. And we can clearly see, like over here, there's a case where if this is like Bob and Alice working on something, Alice on the top and Bob working down there, Alice creates commit number 4, and then Bob creates commit number 3 in tandem, and then at some point that all gets merged up at commit number 6. So there's something really interesting that kind of naturally arises from this setup where we have this nice declarative graph. Like we haven't described any sort of tedious process by which to reconstruct history or something like that. We just have this nice visual sort of pictorial representation of the relationships between the different commits. And one of the neat things that we can do with that is you can very trivially move forward or back. So in this case, we have the master branch currently over there at commit 6. If we wanted to move that back to commit 4, visually, you just take that and drag it over 1, or drag it over 2 or 3, it doesn't really matter. You're really just moving that one little pointer or tag conceptually. And if you look at on the disk, you're really not doing much more than that either. So you have this sort of nice atomic way to move around forwards or back. And so that kind of simplifies things a whole lot in terms of trying to figure out how would you the alternative to this sort of thing with the version control is like I said, something, unintuitive and crazy. This is just sort of the natural way to do things, to represent a graph of commits varying over time. I think one of the things that's easy to take for granted here is that, yes, this works with Git, but have you ever thought about trying to apply that to configuration management, the state of your system? And that's pretty much the core, I would argue, of what NixOS does, is it has a sort of realization that if you were to describe the set of everything that's installed at one point in time, be it executables and binaries, configuration settings, system D units or whatever, if you could kind of lay it out like this, then you could easily, in NixOS's case, bump one symlink and you've completely changed what you have set up. So it makes rollback, rolling forward, super, super straightforward, and cheap, and atomic. So that's kind of hopefully, hopefully kind of paints like a picture, kind of gives you a bit of intuition about where we want to go with this description of like what NixOS is and how it works. I guess I'd like to stop and see if anybody has any questions so far. All right, cool. So with that, I'd like to kind of dive into some rather scary live stuff. And I kind of want to, rather than try to give a whole bunch of definitions about things and try to build this bottom-up kind of definition of what NixOS is and how it works, I think I'd rather kind of start from the top. And so what we'll do is we'll work through what you would expect on a typical Linux distro, and how does that kind of compare to what we have with NixOS. That'll hopefully kind of allow us to naturally kind of learn as we go. So probably one of the first things that I'd like to look at is where are things like core utils, where is RM? If I were to do something like this, and can everybody read this? I blew up the font like crazy big, so hopefully it's good. So there we go. Maybe not what you're expecting. So it's run current system SW, probably for software, bin RM. That looks pretty much nothing like what you would expect. And the sort of oddity doesn't stop there. Oh, yes?
Can you see the
map? Yeah, if I were to, let me see here. Oh, you want to look at my path, like as in that? I don't know if that's illuminating at all. But I'll get back to that in a moment. First, I'd like to, so speaking of the whole like, where's the RM thing? Okay, that looks strange. It gets even more strange, believe it or not. So if I do this, that probably looks super weird. Like, show of hands if you think that looks completely bonkers. Yeah, right? Like, you're lying if you don't have your hands up. That looks super, or you use NixOS, and cool, I'm glad you're here. But like, that's super weird. And I remember looking at this thinking like, what in the unholy hell is going on? So kind of breaking this down, kind of get a sense of like, just why, how. When we install something, in this case, it's core utils, and it kind of gives it away a little bit there towards the end of the path. You can see core utils dash 8.25. So I can probably kind of logic that out. That probably looks like the package is core utils and the version is 8.25. Now, the gobbledygook that looks like some base 64 encoding or something like that, that happens to be a hash of the description of how to build core utils. In this case, a specific incantation of core utils. I'll very shortly get into what is that description I'm speaking of, that build description. But kind of suffice it to say right now that that description uniquely identifies core utils in its present state right there in that path. So if I were to do something like use a different GCC version or something like that, it would be reflected there. Similarly, if I were to use a different tarball, for the source of core utils, exactly the same, the SHA would be something different. So everything, all the packages that we install in NixOS ultimately get put in under nix/store/, and then some prefix specifically for that package consisting of the hash of that build description, and then it's hyphen, package name, hyphen, and then the package version. So I can actually do this. Helps if I do the right thing. Font is crazy big, but if you kind of squint, you can see that this is a sort of specific prefix for this core utils. Bin and share and all that stuff. So again, super strange looking, but we'll get to why that's important. But to kind of touch on that, where I said that one of the major problems with the sort of foundation of how Linux generally works conventionally, where you dump everything into this common dumping grounds, kind of avoid that, you have to have some way to uniquely place packages with respect to how they are built in different places. So that's exactly what you're seeing there. You're seeing, rather than some big global mutable store, you have these immutable individual store paths, as we call them, which are prefixes for the software to be installed into. So where do I want to go with this now? Yeah, so I guess to hop along into what does that build description look like? So pointing out that hash. Oh, kind of big. Let me see here. So what is generating that hash? How do we describe how the package is built? So for that, Nix, the package manager, uses an expression language sort of unfortunately called Nix also. So now there's this wonderful overloading where the package manager is called Nix, but also the language is called Nix. But generally, you can kind of logic out like what is being referred to by context pretty easily. So in this case, this is the source code, plus or minus a little bit, for the hello package, which is just really only just prints hello world, if you haven't seen it. But generally, it's the idea behind the hello program is kind of give you an idea of how might you package things and do things according to like the GNU philosophy and that kind of thing. So picking this apart, there's probably some stuff that looks fairly reasonable. There's a name, we're saying it's hello, and then there's hyphen, and then the version, that version part actually gets parsed out. We have a source, so we say fetch this URL, we give it that URL and a SHA-256.
Yep. Did the SHA-256 not fit in the...
No, it didn't, which is why that is not exactly a SHA-256. That's like a truncation of it, because I couldn't fit it in the slide. But that is the idea. Very good catch. Yes. So normally there would be correct SHA-256 is not broken things like this. But for the sake of cramming it all in one slide, there we go. So we also have... let's see, what do we have? I've elided the metadata. Normally there would be stuff for license, description, other stuff. What platforms you can build it on. Because Nix, a package manager, will actually run on Linux. It'll also run on, I keep wanting to call it Darwin, because it's just like bad habit, but Mac OS. And also I think we have like FreeBSD and maybe other stuff I don't know, but I don't use it. Kind of breaking this down further, I mean, we have the hello package, we have the source. Like, if I can maybe take a look at like what is going on here with the language, because it's kind of interesting. Yeah.
How does it work that it knows where the new mirror is?
Unfortunately, that was one of the things I couldn't quite fit in there, but we have a, in this case, that's self-contained. So we have a file in the Nix packages repository, and to clarify, Nix packages, if you were to go to github.com/nixos/nixpackages, that would be the repo for all of the source for all of our packages, unsurprisingly, and also all of the NixOS modules, which is how we approach configuration management. So in that repo, there is a file that describes all the mirrors, and that fetch URL sort of little utility function there will actually look at the content of that mirror mapping. That way it can fall back if you have some sort of connectivity problem or that kind of thing.
Does it go to the fastest one, or will it go to the same mirror?
I think it's just sequential. I'm not entirely sure. I totally forget. So kind of breaking this down further. I don't want to do this. So the very top, kind of squint, almost looks like it's taking two arguments, and that's because it is. This Nix expression is a function of a bunch of attributes, as we call them. So in this case, we're taking something called standardenv, we're taking something called fetch URL as named arguments. The thing that gives that away specifically is there's this little semicolon down there at the end of the first line. And so the left-hand side is the argument, or arguments in this case. It's kind of like pattern matching in a way. We'll kind of touch on that in a moment. But on the left-hand side, it's the argument or arguments, depending on how you look at it. And the right-hand side, which is everything but the first line down there, is whatever the function is going to evaluate to. So you give us standard env and fetch URL, and the idea is that we, as this function, to sort of personify it, give you back a package. The package is built by using the standard env.make derivation thing. And the name sounds kind of funny, but the idea is that generally our packages are a little bit more nuanced than the packages in other systems. So it's almost sort of like a misnomer to call it that. I guess what I'm getting at is the proper naming is derivation. Everything like where RM was installed, that prefix, the thing that built that is what we would call a derivation. And thus the nomenclature here, where I say standard env.make derivation. So standard env.make derivation basically allows us to create a so-called derivation using a sort of standard environment where we'll have GCC, presumably, unless you're on unless you're on Darwin, in which case you'll have Clang, but you'll have whatever the system's default GCC or C compiler set up, a handful of utility things, and so on and so forth. It's just a standard environment for building stuff in. That's kind of the gist of it here. Just to elaborate just a tiny bit more, if it kind of looks like JavaScript, that's actually a pretty good first approximation, because there's little curly brackets, and then we have like URL equals, and then SHA-256 equals, and on the outer scope here, name equals, do check equals, that sort of thing. Those are like key names, and then on the right-hand side of the equal sign, you have a value. So that all gets evaluated to what is sort of morally equivalent to a JSON object. So what the Nix package manager will do if you give it this thing, in this case, the description of how to build hello, is it will evaluate that code, and what that will result in is that derivation thing I was referring to, which is essentially like a serialization of all the stuff that makes up that derivation. So the idea is that the Nix expression language gives you a way to have abstraction, you have functions, you have variables, that sort of thing. And with that, you can build up packages. It would be kind of a shame if you had to evaluate that stuff all the time to be able to build a package, say. It's kind of nice to be able to serialize that and kind of boil it down into something you don't have to execute. It just is the data. And that's precisely what this is. If you squint really hard, you can see that the very first thing under derive describes, there's out, and then the thing after that is some store path. And then much like with core utils, there's hello, dash, and then the version of hello there. And what that's describing there is the one and only output in this case, because we have multiple outputs per derivation. Give a sort of intuition of like, what does that mean? Why would you want that? You can kind of think to like dev versions of packages on your distro of choice versus like the base one with all the executables and those sorts of goodies. If you're not going to be doing a development of something, you don't need the headers, so you shave off a lot of space by not including that. So in this case, hello just has one output, and that's this path right here, hello-2.10. And immediately after that, there are the derivations or packages that hello depends on here when you're building it. And then there's this builder.sh or default builder.sh, and that comes from the sort of core standard env building machinery from Nix packages. And so what that's saying is this is the script to run to kick off the build of hello. If we look at that again real quick, you'll notice that we never had to do anything like make install, that kind of thing that you would expect, because it will actually just attempt to do those things. The standard env make derivation will attempt to do those things for you automatically, unless told otherwise. So for most things you would ever want to build, you just kind of give it a source, a name, maybe some metadata, and then you're done. Except for things that are a pain in the butt, like, well, Mesos was one, where you have Python stuff and Java stuff and C++ stuff kind of all in one big soup. So that gets kind of tricky to build. But in this case, super straightforward. And so again, that's what that that builder.sh is. It's just some shell script that attempts to see, oh, can I like make, can I make install, that kind of thing. Yeah.
This printout, you're saying that this that derivation creates, this is part of like a bash script?
So behind the scenes this is happening, I personally don't generally care too much about it. I'm showing you guys because I think it kind of helps to understand what's going on in the inner workings. And there will be something I want to note about this. But generally, you don't ever think about it at this level. It's kind of almost like being a C programmer, and then you know, it kind of helps if you understand your instruction set and some assembler, but you don't always have to dip down that far. So this is just a serialized version of what would happen if you were to execute this. So it evaluates that code there, and then out comes this static chunk of stuff, which is a useful distinction because, again, this is kind of slow. You're talking about running a Turing complete language on this file. You got to evaluate the stuff. And who knows? I mean, look at the fetch URL. You know, is it 10 lines of code making up that function, or is it 1,000? So it could be, there could be a cost associated with any part of this thing being a Turing complete language. But if you're to compare that to something like a protobuf or JSON or something like that, where it's just a static chunk of data, there's no evaluation process, you just slurp it in, and then you're ready to go. So behind the scenes, this gets turned into that in Nix's sort of internal model. So I think to pick up from where I was, the very last thing that's kind of interesting here is that last little array starting at do check one, and then there's out, and then, so if you look at these, they're essentially pairs. You have do check and one, out, some out path, and then there's source. And so you should be able to kind of see where that's coming from. There's do check equals true. That's do check is one. We have the source there. So what's going on is that portion of this derivation is describing when the Nix package manager actually builds the package, what environment variables to pass along. So you'll have do check equals one, and then you'll have out corresponding to the out path, which is the Nix store path. So assuming your package is built correctly, it should be attempting to use that out environment variable as the prefix into which to install and build everything. And then source is, you know, corresponds with the tarball. And the idea is that before trying to build, you would have some sort of source unpacking phase and it would consult that. And that's precisely what standard.makeDerivation does. So it by default assumes that you have, if you look at the bash part, that script, builder.sh, behind the scenes, the thing actually gets evaluated, it expects that by convention, source will be an environment variable through this mechanism pointing at the source tarball. Do check if it sees it set to something other than an empty string. Will attempt to run whatever check phase of the corresponding build tool you're using. Because also, you can, if you were to pass along like CMake in here, it's also smart enough to do the corresponding thing for CMake and other build systems and that sort of thing. So we try to make everything as kind of convenient as possible with hopefully not quite as much magic as Rails, like I was digging on earlier. Or as I like to say, a little less magic than Hogwarts. Is always good, but you can generally kind of look at the package definition here, the expression, and kind of see what it's doing. There's usually not too much magic. Yeah. Yeah.
So the entire slide is mostly arrays, except for two lines over there, right under builder.h. What are the two random strings in the middle?
Yeah. So the first one there, x86_64-linux. So that's the variant of whatever processor architecture you're running and operating system. So in this case, this was built for x86 64 Linux. The next thing is the executable to actually run, to kick off the build. And I'll get more into like how does it actually happen, like in what environment does bin bash run, like how does that work? I'll touch on that in a bit, but the idea is Nix Package Manager, when it comes time to actually build the corresponding output, the package for this derivation, it will run bash, pass it that array that immediately follows, dash e, the builder.sh, and then it'll also ensure that those environment variables that I described will be there. Does that describe or help? Cool. And then to look at one more of these things real quick, but not in quite as much detail, here's the actual source derivation corresponding to this. You can see up there in the name, it's hello-2.10.tar.gz. And in this case, it looks a little bit different than before, because immediately following that, there's a SHA-256, whereas over here, there was not. It immediately goes over here, and the hello derivation immediately goes into what things do you depend on at build time. And over here, we have the SHA-256. So that gets to this kind of points out this distinction between two different kinds of derivations you can have. And if you look over here where I said the SHA-256 was important, Nix actually wouldn't let you attempt to fetch that URL unless you provided the SHA-256. The reason being, because most build processes, most derivations in Nix, say you're compiling some code, they're actually built, the build process is happening in, it was probably a namespace or something like that to prevent networking. So you can't have access to the network when you're building a package. And you also can't look around at the rest of the system. So we do bind mounts to map in just what's necessary, and then kind of hide, squirrel everything away, and then do a ch root. So you're in this like little jail. If the terminology left anybody behind, you're like in this little jail when you're building, in this case, hello, where all that, in this case, it was bash running that script, right? So there's bash running dash e and then builder.sh. All that bash process can see is the environment variables that were declared there, of course, the arguments given to it, and then the corresponding outputs for the derivations provided there towards the top. That's all it can see. And that kind of poses a problem if you actually need to fetch some source code in the first place, logically. If you have no network access, how do you ever get your hands on the source code? So there's a second distinct kind of derivation, which is called a fixed output derivation. And the idea is that you know ahead of time what the SHA-256, or I think we also have like SHA-512 now. The idea is you know what that is ahead of time. And so you can specify that, and then you can get rid of the network, the lack of a network, or conversely, or said another way, you can have the network now and fetch the tarball. If the SHA-256 does not match up in this case, Nix would actually reject it. So it would attempt to is this fetch URL? So there's another thing called fetch zip, which will try to unpack and then check the SHA. But in this case, it just for like verbatim, like curls down tar.gz, checks the SHA-256. If it doesn't match, it explodes. Says, hey, this doesn't match what I was expecting. The reason for that is because getting back to that whole determinism thing that we really care about, we want to ensure that given any sort of Nix expression or the derivations that come out of that process, we want to always get the same result from the same inputs, which gets back to that functional idea. So the idea is that you can't have the source vary, because we described the SHA-256, and we've also pinned down kind of behind the scenes, in this case there's some abstraction, but there is a specific version of GCC, there's a specific version of core utils and all the other stuff in the build process by way of what was outlined here, there towards the top. And if any of those things change, you get a different hash, and therefore you get a different store path. So you're guaranteed for a given expression to get the same output, plus or minus like you may not get like bit identical builds, but yeah.
You won't, because ELF headers have the timestamp.
So yeah, so there are things like that. And you also have things like, so you won't always have bit identical builds. We try to shoot for it as much as we can, but there's also stuff like profile guided optimization and that sort of thing. You run that, well, okay, by definition, you're not going to have the same build. And so that's kind of one of those things. We actually have this really big issue open on GitHub where we're trying to decide like just how far do we want to go to trying to get everything completely bit identical, reproducible. And there's certainly some value there, but maybe not if you're going to like put 10 or 20% performance on the table by just dropping stuff like profile guided optimization. So we're still kind of trying to figure out like what the proper middle ground is, that kind of thing. But yeah, so there's no guarantee you'll get bit identical builds. But the idea is, unless like you have some really weird stuff, like your compiler has multiple threads and itself is a non-deterministic buggy thing, then the idea is, aside from that, you should get the same functional result. Can't really help people's buggy compilers, though. So that is kind of the gist of how the expression language works. It gets kind of boiled down into this derivation format. So does anybody have any questions so far that I can answer real quick?
Just for the after the lecture, do you have Skier available on any bootable live media? The reason I ask is because I have a high performance machine here, mm-hmm. but this, I think it's the graphics card or something, but with every different distro of Linux, it exhibits different bizarre behavior. It might be interesting to see what it does.
Yeah, that would be interesting for me as well to see. So personally, as a Mac owner, it's been interesting to kind of use a euphemism to describe trying to run Linux on it. Of course, if you've heard about the new Mac, like they have the touch bar thing, and as you might reasonably expect, of course, Linux won't run like at all, just will not even boot. So I've had my share of.
But it's got a graphical interface too, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Some of the bigger attractive. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So problems regarding like you described, where you have a different directory in which you need to configure other than the root of the source directory and that sort of thing, really isn't a problem. I can show some other packages where we do more fancy things, but you have free rein to before any individual build phase. Which I'm not really touching on right now, but any of like if you logically consider a build process, it's like, you know, unpack the source, maybe do some patching, configure it, build it, install it. Between any one of those phases, you can put in whatever sort of bash you want, you can drop into bash and then execute Python. It doesn't really matter. You have free rein to do whatever you need to do to get your package built.
Would that be in the metadata?
So you're saying, would the source that you're wanting to build have some sort of description of? I mean, we don't really have anything like that. We're having a lot of adoption, but we're still not like critical mass, and so I don't think we've been successful at sort of convincing other people to make things easier on us. So no, we don't really have any sort of convention that we've managed to impose upon. The rest of the people or setting up the configuration and build processes for their source code to make it easy on us.
Well, I mean, GCC won't build.
Right. Yeah. That's kind of true of a lot of things. So I guess what I'd like to do is, now that I've described the Nix expression language, how we get these derivations. I guess I'd like to touch on why that's useful that we have this. I mean, I described the performance aspect. Obviously, running and executing code is going to be slower than just deserializing something. But another really useful and powerful thing about this is that you can, now that you have this thing serialized, and it describes all the other derivations it depends on, you can send that over the wire and you can have somebody else build something for you. And again, because the descriptions are guaranteed plus or minus like variants at the byte level, because everything's guaranteed to be functionally equivalent, there's no trouble in saying I'll have an arbitrary machine running the same processor architecture, at least, build the stuff for me because it's a nice beast of a machine, and then I'll have it send over the results, that kind of thing. And then introspection is nice as well. You can easily see how something was built, what versions went in. So with that out of the way, I'd like to touch on how configuration management itself works. I think that was all kind of prerequisite to kind of to get a sense of like what's going on with the Nix store and how Nix expression work, et cetera. So one thing I'll do first is actually come back and revisit this run current system business. If I do this here, we'll see that it creates, or it points out that run current system is actually a symlink to NixStore, blah, 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 NixOS system, C-Strahan, more stuff. So when I mentioned the git commit graph as having this nice, wonderful property of you can just change, you can move forward and backwards just by moving that one reference, that's actually how we managed to make changing to a different configuration state, just bumping one symlink, is this run current system has is a symlink to specifically that sort of snapshot, if you will, of NixOS in that configuration state. So just bumping the symlink, I can move forward and backwards. Which implies, if I look over here, so there's stuff like systemd, there's the initrd, there's the init script you can poke around at. And it's kind of all there. So moving on from that, how is stuff configured? How do you actually configure your system? And to do that, I think I'll start by poking around at my config. No profanity in there. So starting up here, I have some notes there to myself that don't really matter. The hashes are comments. So again, we have another function, any sort of, in this case, this is my configuration.nix that actually I point NixOS at when I want to configure my system. Right there at the start, it's a function of the whole system config, like all the configuration settings, sort of almost seemingly paradoxically, even the settings all set in here are contained in config. If that kind of blows your mind, the reason, assuming you can follow that at all, the reason that that works is because NixOS is also a lazy language, so you can do really weird stuff, like you can have the fixed point of a function, you can say, give to me, some recursive notion of what I'm about to give back, often called tying the knot. So you get this weird loopy thing where, yeah, I set config down, some configuration settings down here, and then I can access them through this config thing that I was given. It's kind of weird, but the idea is config here is all the configuration settings across both this file and then anything this file imports. In this case, I have hardware configuration.nix in which I've just stuffed all of my hardware specific stuff. And then I also have Nginx stuff separated out because it got kind of big. So there's all sorts of stuff in here. I have the kernel modules that I want to have available. I specify up here that I want to use systemd boot to as my bootloader rather than grub, which is also just as usable. I should probably clarify, I've kind of implied it, but I don't know if I clearly stated it. NixOS does use systemd for its init system. And then again, you have your choice between grub or systemd boot, formerly gummy boot, I believe. And so let's find something interesting here. Because I think most of us here, when it comes to getting paid, we want to get services out and running somewhere. So here I have Zookeeper. This could just as well be your own service. You could define your own sort of abstraction for how do I run my own e-commerce site or whatever. And then you could just have, you know, my amazing service dot enable equals true, and then you're set. So in here, I have Zookeeper set to be enabled. So the idea is that I'll have a systemd unit there, and we'll have all the necessary stuff set up to execute Zookeeper and set up the environment, that kind of thing. I can actually look at that running right now. So there it is running. And sort of unsurprisingly, again, the pass would not look like what you would see in a conventional Linux setup. We have the service is tucked away, again, in some Nix store path. We have description of you know what's running here, in this case, Java, unsurprisingly, class path, et cetera. So you can see Zookeeper's running there. Configuring it was super easy. It was that one line, unless I want to add more stuff and I can, but I just the defaults are fine for me. So that kind of raises the question, what does that look like to actually set up a module to configure Zookeeper? Because it's kind of not just enough to use the stuff that's already defined. You probably want to be able to, again, like I said, get your own e-commerce site set up or whatever you have that you need to run. So looking over at the Nix packages tree, I can go hunt that down. So this is the NixOS module for Zookeeper. Again, takes the config set of all the options you have set for the machine you're configuring. There's also a little helpful like lib thing where you can do like lib.sort or like get some numbered elem of an array, that kind of thing. So just a bunch of utility things. And then packages up here is all of the Nix packages that are defined. So the whole, sort of the whole shebang. Any package you would want to access, you could use it by referring to like packages dot and then say Zookeeper, that kind of thing. And this is all just Nix expression language again. If I go hunt down the systemd service, since that's what we were looking at, actually before I do that, you can see I've set up, whoever wrote this module has a setup so that if you enable Zookeeper, you get a Zookeeper user, which is configured to have the Zookeeper corresponding Zookeeper ID, description, the home directory, that sort of thing you'd expect for a user. This is exactly what it looks like if you're wanting to have a module, like in this case Zookeeper, set up a user for yourself, or if you wanted to, if you're configuring, say, your own machine and you just want to have a user for some specific use, you can declare it just like that. In fact, hopefully without getting too distracted, we can see here's another extra users thing and here's me. Network manager, that kind of thing. So back to Zookeeper. Looking at the systemd, how we specify systemd units, it looks kind of just like this. We say systemd.services. And then whatever name you want there and assign it to the sort of usual suspects, a description, what is it wanted by, what does it need to be ordered after, what do you need in the environment, that kind of thing. let's see. So probably the most important thing about having a unit is you can actually run it. So looking at the exec start pragma here. It is this funky looking little string. And I should point out that this little dollar curly in a string, like all this stuff, and then the closing curly there, all of this is a interpolation. So the Nix expression language allows you to interpolate like one string into another. So what we're doing is we're saying, take the JRE package and then take that as a string and then stuff it in, you know, if you're to like render that string, it'd get plunked right in there. And if we go back and look at the unit real quick, so you can actually see that's what that Java path is there, jre/bin/java-cp. So that explodes out into the full store path for that corresponding package. So I should probably reiterate that and make it really explicit. Whenever you want to refer to one package from, say, the build process of another package definition, or if you're wanting to, in this case, set up like a systemd unit, what you do is you can interpolate, or we also have like plus, you can concatenate strings with plus, doesn't really matter. You can treat a package as a string. You can coerce it to a string. And the string that you get for that derivation object, that package, is the resulting store path for that thing. So that's exactly what we're seeing here with the jre/bin/java. Comes directly from this. And then if we were to squint and look at some of the other stuff on that line, we'd also see the zookeeper jar location itself. There's also some extra command line options that kind of get spliced in here. Let me take a look at that. So when I enabled Zookeeper back over here, and all I said was Zookeeper.enable equals true, that corresponds to this setting over here. So we can say the Zookeeper module consists of these settings: enable, yes or no, or true false, what port you want it running on, that sort of thing. So each option is declared in this sort of fashion where you say you give a name to the option that you want, and then say equals and make option and a bunch of attributes here in this case the description of the option, here clearly whether to enable Zookeeper, what it should default to. So in this case, we don't just want Zookeeper to always be running unless you explicitly say no, so the default is false. And then what is the type expected from the user using this option. And so while Nix, the expression language, is dynamically typed, we do, when you try to configure your system, look at what was given and see if it clearly doesn't match through this mechanism at runtime by saying, this expects a Boolean, you gave me a string. So figure out what you're trying to do. So that's enable, there's port. In this case, type equals types.int, have the default Zookeeper port. It's all fairly straightforward stuff here. You can also have string-based stuff. So in this case, there's an option called extraconf that just takes a bunch of lines of text, and we'll just put it directly in the conf file. So we look over here, there's Zookeeper config, merges in those config settings by the user. If I follow this along to see where does this get used, you can see that we build up a config directory in which we drop the log4j properties and a zookeeper.config file. And the content of that zoo.config will be that text there. So again, data dir, client port auto purge, et cetera. So we'll actually just kind of on the fly, as we need to, create probably like the world's simplest package or derivation. This write text dir function will actually take two things. It'll take the name of the derivation that you want. And then it'll take a string, and it'll just drop that text into a file in that and the build output of that derivation. So what we actually get is a store path with literally just a zoo.config in that text. Something we haven't seen yet, which is kind of interesting, is build env. And what it does is, again, takes a name for this derivation it's going to build. And then it takes a second thing called paths. And what paths is an array to other packages or the outputs for the given derivations. It'll take an array of those, and it'll actually create a symlink forest of all the things that you gave it. So in this case, this configdir here will be an output with a symlink pointing to the result of this derivation being built, and also another symlink over here to the second thing, with the corresponding name. So it just creates a sort of forest of symlinks. What's kind of neat about that is you can kind of glom together the trees that you need for stuff like configuration, all the stuff you'd put in Etsy, in this case, this one like sort of container directory with the corresponding files in it. You can kind of glam all of that together really cheaply because it's all just symlinks. And managing that, there's zero management because Nix just manages all the stuff for you. So you don't have to worry about weird stuff like dangling symlinks and that kind of thing. So it's super cheap, no inherent problems to it. And it's also the sort of base mechanism by which we build up things like, if we go back over here, like that right there. So that is actually just a big, massive build env. We have all the little pieces kind of put together modularly to make up the state of the system, which also has another big implication, this idea of taking a bunch of different derivations and then symlinking them together as you need. Because NixOS knows that for a given derivation, it has a specific output and you'll always get the same output, building something once is sufficient for it to know that it doesn't need to rebuild it. If you already have the output of the thing that would have been generated, you don't need to do it again if you try to build something. To kind of make that a little concrete, I can do next build, okay, and I can say, the Nix packages. So I want to build something that is in the official Nix packages repo, and the thing I want to build is hello. If I run that, you'll see it just immediately returns and says, oh, it's that thing right there. That's because I built that before I came up here onto the stage. If I hop along and let's see here, let's say I tweak this in some way. So if I come over here and I put in something like foo equals bar, so what would happen here is foo would be passed along as an environment variable. That's clearly different than how it was before. There was no foo equals bar. There was no foo environment variable. So as a result, the hash would have to change. So what I can do to kind of demonstrate that this would actually have to rebuild, and then I can really hope the internet works, is I can say my source tree build hello. And sure enough, there it goes. If I scroll up here a little bit, I might be able to see something. In this case, I already had all of the necessary stuff to build it, sort of unsurprisingly, because the only things you need are like GCC and bash and like one or two other things. So I already had all of that. Otherwise, it would attempt to, if I tried to build hello here and I didn't have all the build inputs I needed, it would actually attempt to fetch from our Hydra server, as we call it, which is like a continuous integration thing that builds all of our packages and allows us to have both binary and source like mixed installs. Let's see here. So it would attempt, the build process would attempt to reach out to Hydra and say, give me everything I don't presently have. Because I don't want to try to build like 20 different dependencies. That would be really time consuming. In this case, I already had everything, so there's nothing to show there. And so let's see, so everything builds, and yeah, so there we go. So I have hello. But that hash is going to be different than if I were to undo that. XW, yeah, so a little different. Let's see. Yeah, so yeah, so as I was saying, the Symlink sort of approach is really nice for being able to put different binary like outputs that we need in different locations and have that happen really cheaply. Because as I just demonstrated, you don't need to rebuild something that's already built if you already have the binary result. So you don't have to rebuild something to glom a bunch of stuff into some folders. You just end up with symlinks. All right. Does anybody have any questions or curious about? Yeah. Okay. What do you?
Curious about? I have a question. Let's just say that I had. Okay. So yeah, this is zookeeper.nix that comes with NixOS. But let's just say like I'm not. Let's just say I want to change like the config variable, right? Mm-hmm. Instead of editing the file, is there a way for me to make my own zookeeper? It just says it kind of like inherits, but config variables now. This like for example. I might want the extra config on the front instead of in the back.
Right. I guess to kind of restate the question. So you're wondering if you can kind of create your own sort of zookeeper rather than have to abstraction or module.
Inherit zookeeper and then change the config variable, use this config variable instead.
So to some degree, yes. What we try to do is we try to set up the modules that you get out of the box such that they're not lacking in any sort of dimension of configurability. So where you were describing where, you know, what if I have a concern that it was putting those config lines, say, over here, right, extraconf, and I'll go back to it. So there's extraconf, and it's putting it below those things. In this case, as best as I understand, the order doesn't matter here. So we don't really have any sort of like, you know, before conf or after conf or any notion like that. So in this case, it probably shouldn't matter for specifically that concrete problem that you're describing. But in the more general sense of like, you know, what if there are some assumptions that we're making that aren't really good assumptions? In that case, I would consider that a bug. And if you need some sort of ordering constraint on, you know, the like up here, where in theory this stuff may not always want to be at the top and maybe we really want it down here, like logically anyways. If we don't give you enough flexibility to be able to set that sort of ordering, I would consider that a bug and should just probably be fixed in the NixOS stuff.
For example, I guess where I'm looking at it more is like for some configurations like a mail server, mm-hmm. that can be incredibly complicated.
Yeah.
When I looked at NixOS, it looked like, let's put it this way, I might not be that proficient with the mail server itself, so mm-hmm. I may use a configuration that's already done. So I would like to have like my mail config could be like, okay, you know what, I'm going to skip whatever you did and say, mail config is this giant string.
Yeah,
I'm just kind of write it all out as a normal config, but then use NixOS for it. So that's why I want to know if I can say, okay, yeah. inherit postfix, and then change this like postfix config equal to this new value.
Right,
but I can use all the existing values on everything else.
Absolutely. So again, we try to make it so that you don't have to jump through any hoops at all, preferably, and you can just declaratively state. But in the case where you need some sort of, you know, like escape door, some sort of back, what's that? Wait, what's that?
What is this Ed?
Oh, it's Vim. yes, so you can use something called make force. You can forcibly override something that we would have built up in maybe some way where there were some assumptions that didn't work in your scenario. And again, I think pretty much everybody would really appreciate it if there was something we missed, it just got kind of folded in into the Nix packages modules. But there's definitely nothing keeping you from sort of a quick solution of like, I just want to like bulldoze whatever in this one little area of, you know, whatever was set. So over here in my configuration, I could do something at least sort of morally equivalent to like zookeeper dot, you know, conf or extra conf, that kind of thing. If I can spell something like that, you could put whatever you would want. And you would just totally steamroll whatever that, whatever the module was doing to concatenate all the different sections or whatever. Or say like Nginx, that's probably actually a better example. If I come along over to so here for Nginx, I have some HTTP config stuff here. So it really starts here. So I have an upstream server part, that sort of thing. And what's going to happen is if I go look at the Nginx module, OS Nginx, so there's config file right here. Let's use there. Close. So there's a part where we concatenate everything together, and it does make some assumptions that you may not like, I suppose. Really hard to navigate around in huge font. So maybe you can just trust me, but you could do something like put whatever config you wanted there and then just totally steam over whatever. So there definitely are escape hatches if there's something that isn't quite working the way it should or doesn't give you enough sort of leeway. Yeah?
Quick question. In some of the configs, I think we have had a dot 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 in the arguments. What is that? Because in the argument, you at one point mentioned in the first two things, FTDN and fetch URL, the arguments, and the rest of the file was the, I guess, the definition of that function.
Mm-hmm.
Is dot 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 just and variable arguments?
Here, let me see if I come over here. Are you referring specifically to like this slide or?
You look at your configuration.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah, no, I right, like up here. Yes. So I kind of struggled with like how much did I want to dive into the language itself, because it's kind of a weird language, like if we're honest. And it has a bunch of weird kind of quirks that aren't common to just about any other language I know. But this dot 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 right there is saying that if we're trying to destructure that argument on the left hand side of the colon, because this is a function, right? Left hand side's argument gets destructured into config, lib, and packages, and that's the everything below is the value that gets evaluated. That dot 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 says that you could give me more attributes, like that config attribute, lib, packages, et cetera. You could give me something else, like foo, and I could have a value of bar or something like that. And it's not going to trip me up. If I left out the dot, 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 and then whoever was calling me gave me something extraneous, it would actually fail immediately and give an error saying unexpected.
But without binding it.
Wait, what's that?
It's like pattern matching without binding it to a name.
Yes, yeah. So it's just saying, yeah, we will permit anything else that wasn't explicitly stated there, and we're not going to complain. Without it, anything extra, and it'll fail.
You can't reference it inside the actual function definition. We can't arbitrarily.
So these, the kind of like splat or whatever you want to call it. So leaving this just as it is, you can't. But what I can do, since you asked, is I can do something like that. This part on the right-hand side of the at sign, the naming is inconsequential. Name it what you want, but kind of logical to call it args. And then now args is the think of it like that JSON object, we call it attribute sets. Args would be the entire attribute set. It wouldn't just be where we've sort of pattern matched and pulled out config, lib, and packages as individual bindings. Args is the entire thing. Yes, you absolutely could. And there are other cases where it's kind of useful. Like right now, it kind of seems like, all right, well, what's the point? But you know, why not just go ahead and name it up here? But there are some cases where it can be kind of useful.
So add off, you did ask, add off would be as pattern?
Yeah, I think that sounds about right. So yeah, so args just names everything. Let's see here, so, yeah.
So why write your own pre-existing
Python? Well, so we wanted, kind of getting back to the determinism thing, we wanted a pure language, so that kind of rules out Ruby and Python. Yeah, I guess I'm kind of being abstract there. So, yeah, we want a pure functional programming. So we could also do that. And there's some people who, so there's a lot of mindshare in common between Haskell and NixOS, probably unsurprising with the same buzzwords being kind of thrown about by both sides. And there are a lot of Haskellers that are like really bummed. They're like, dude, why isn't it stackly typed or like just Haskell? And I can kind of see that argument, but as a sort of practical matter, there are some things that are kind of nice here, which I must admit, as a sort of statically typed system weenie myself, there's still stuff that I like about how this works out, because I can do the sort of thing where I can say, give me a package, which is a collection of attributes, right? Like the name of the package. If I take a package, like if I were to do packages.gcc or something like that, that would evaluate to an attribute set. But then I can also interpolate it really conveniently into another string and get the output, I can get the store path embedded in there. So there are things that are nice about it by kind of having it be an internal DSL rather than some sort of like external domain specific language thing. But I definitely know a lot of people that wish it were Haskell or something similar.
Sure that the problem that shows all the
particular detail calculation. Yeah. I see what you're saying. Yes. If everything pans out right. If we meet our schedules. So that'd be the next version. So I'm running off of the unstable, not necessarily tip of master. I kind of alluded to a continuous integration thing we have going for us, which I can actually show off. Internet works, this will be exciting. Sweet. So that continuous integration thing I was alluding to earlier. So that's what Hydra is here. And maybe a little dehydrated. I totally forgot what was asked. What was the question again? It was, right, so yeah. So I don't personally track the tip of master necessarily. What I'll do is we have this notion of channels. And the idea is we have a whole gamut of test cases that we run NixOS through to make sure everything's going to work and not blow up on you. Whenever what we call an evaluation, where we take the entire Nix packages tree and we do all sorts of stuff like behind the scenes spin up virtual machines and check that things are behaving the right way. For example, I think there's like a zookeeper test that we'll check to see like, all right, if I ask for Zookeeper to be running, and I spin up a container with Zookeeper running in it, is it there? Can I communicate with it? That kind of thing. So if all those tests pass for a given evaluation of Nix packages, then what will happen is the channel, the like Nix packages unstable channel, will get bumped. And so I'll just track that. I'm kind of lazy, so there's this convenient way where that continuous integration system, Hydra, will actually, whenever something successfully evaluates, where there are no NixOS tests that fail, it'll actually bump the corresponding branch in the Nix packages repository. So in this case, we're seeing that NixOS unstable is looking to be about 8 days old. So there's probably some bleeding edge stuff that's kind of holding it back a little bit from completely passing. So I'm roughly right around there.
So I noticed some 32-bit failure.
Yeah, so we have, this is pretty much like all the, let's see here. This job, NixOS trunk combined, is and then tested. It's pretty much like all of the stuff you could build to ensure that the evaluation is going to work. And so there's all sorts of stuff here. There's like we'll check to see will the graphical ISO build. Can we install from it? That sort of thing. And yeah, as you pointed out, there's some failures here. If you were curious, or if you're like a maintainer of something like myself and wanted to see why did something fail. You can consult this and see, here's a summary of the build, has a unique ID, what was the system was running on, as you mentioned, 32-bit Linux. Look here, there was just one build step to build this CD-ROM image. We can actually go look at the log and see potentially what happened. So there's all this stuff, and I don't know, maybe somewhere down there there's something interesting. Case, who knows? Consult that to kind of get an idea of why did something go wrong. Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about the mechanics of how you would deploy updated configuration.nix files to servers and how you would make them build and configure and change?
Yeah.
There's some NixOps tool.
Exactly. Yeah. So NixOps is the tool by which you would actually configure multiple machines. In my case, sitting at my laptop, it's easy enough for me just to edit the one config file and then point something at it, but point the build process at it. But clearly, it doesn't really scale. Because what are you going to do now? Like SSH up the configuration file or pipe it? Like, you know. So clearly, something's needed, and that thing is what kind of fills the corresponding role of something like Chef or Puppet or that sort of thing. How do you actually get the configuration settings up to all of your servers? How do you manage what EC2 instance has running which thing so that you can keep track of like, oh, this thing was labeled this kind of machine. Oh, it's like a front end machine. This is a back end machine. How do you update all that stuff? So all of that coordination is where NixOps comes in. A little bit out of scope for this talk, but yes, NixOps would be the thing that you actually use to then deploy to a bunch of machines. Look, there's the NixOps manual that goes into detail about all the different things we support. I think it was like half a year ago, or maybe a year at this point, that somebody put a ton of work into making Azure an option. So you can declaratively, again, using the Nix expression language, you can describe all the machines that you want to have running in a certain network.
So this seems super useful, but could you talk a little bit about some security implications?
How so?
It seems like you can have any user building lots of different environments on a machine, like a multi-user machine.
Sure.
I imagine you get multiple users using the same, or try to use the same environment.
Right, well, so with, let's see here, there's kind of a lot of things to touch on in that question. As far as security, so like one of the things I mentioned is it's kind of a pain in the butt when you can't, you know, get into some server and then get something installed that you want to use. That would be sort of like antithetical to what we want with this like whole determinism thing. If I suggested that you can install something and it would have sort of systemic effects, like you shouldn't be able to install as a user, an individual unprivileged user, some version of Nginx or something like that, and have it affect like the, you know, front end Nginx thing you have running somewhere. And so it turns out that's not a problem for us. You can you can you might not have Vim, for example, installed on like the base configuration for the system-wide setting, but as an user, you can come along and say, I want Vim for myself. I can actually kind of show that thing, and it's completely isolated. So actually, I'll show that real quick. So, and then I'll kind of circle back to the broader question. So let's see, what can I install that I don't have installed? So I could say something like, what's that?
Emacs.
Now I have Emacs. I want to switch over, but I've been trying to get a patch into Emacs to support True Color. But I'm running into like, oh sweet, I can turn this into my soapbox. I can't, I want to get this patch in, but the problem is that the maintainer of ncurses term cap, but I don't think that's what I'm thinking. Term info, thank you, yeah. It's like really warm up here. But yes, term info has no interest in making any sort of modification that would allow you to expose the fact that your terminal supports True Color. And I think I saw a hand back there. Give me 1 second, I'll get back to you. But yeah, so like I'd love to use Emacs, but I don't, simply because of silly things like that one day. Yeah, so I can say nixenv-i. Packages, I'll say Ruby. Helps if I tell it to install something. Okay, so here it's saying I just installed Ruby 2.3.1. I say which Ruby, all right, there it is. Oh, but that looks different. That looks different than that run current system, blah, blah, blah. Instead, now it's saying home cstrahan.nixprofile bin Ruby. And so we have this notion of profiles, of which the kind of greater system environment is just another instance, just another profile. In this case, I have my per user profile here, which is what the default is when you try to do like nixenv, this incantation to install a package per user. And so that's completely distinct from the greater system configuration. So if I were to do something like, not Ruby there, something I do have is like, H is there, but Ruby's not. So that's just isolated to my own profile when I installed that thing. So you don't have to, as far as your question, if you're wondering, can you have sort of bad effects from people installing things? You won't have any big problem there, because it's completely decoupled from everybody else's profile as well as the system profile. And then you also don't have to worry about things like systemd units or something like that springing into life and being privileged and doing things, because we also kind of divorce the concept of the package itself, and then in our case, our nomenclature, we call it a module, the thing that then describes the systemd units and that is necessary for running that program. So I can install this or anything else. I can install Nginx here, but it's not going to have any system-wide effect at all. And it all happens unprivileged. There is the concern of if you're building up all these store paths and you're building, kind of looking at that, silly. I go look at this graph again, and we kind of relate it back to that current system idea where we just have a symlink to each kind of state of the system. Yes, thank you. So the problem is you need some sort of way to garbage collect, naturally. Thank you very much. So you need some sort of way to garbage collect, because you'll end up with all this history, and if anything over here, say in commit 4, in this case, my new revision of the way I have my system configured, if anything depends on build results of something that was used before, well, I'm still gonna hold on to that. It's treated just like a garbage collector root in any sort of programming language you would think of. So we need some way to flush that out. So There is a concern of if you let people have free reign to install whatever they want, well, I guess they can potentially blow through whatever quota you'd want them to have for the amount of disk space they can use up. So there is that concern. But you can also just say, you don't have build rights, and the problem's solved. So I don't know if maybe there's a reasonable way that we can kind of have our cake and eat it too, or find some way to say, hey, you've built this kind of stuff, and it's attached to your profile. I think there can be some more smarts around that, but I don't think there's really anything there yet. So no concerns about interference with anything else on your system, with the exception of you might use up a lot of space. Unless you have another idea of something like a security-oriented problem that might arise that I haven't touched on.
No, I assume that if two users were trying to install the same package with the same configuration, they would only have one installation that they would share. I didn't realize they were completely separate.
Right, yeah. So if they're identical, the daemon that's running that is from which you're requesting a build to happen, it would see, all right, I got a couple things going on here, and oh wait, this is exactly the same thing as this other person's building. I'll just hold on a second, and then all right, cool. Now I have the build result. Like now I can unblock the person that was waiting to have that thing built. You kind of killed two birds with one stone. I mean, really, you just built the same package twice, or I mean, you asked it to be built twice, built it once. Yes.
In that situation, are you running with two versions of the package on the disk, or is it smart enough that someone would say, I've already got this package somewhere, and sort of does a copy on write sort of thing, where only one's actually similar to the other?
Wait, run that by me one more time?
So, in the exact situation you said, where I'm user A and user B, we both ask for Nginx, the exact same version. At the end of everything, are there two copies of Nginx on the disk, or is there one, and basically both users sort of wind up with a symlink to it?
So both users, like if they were to do what I did with NixOS to put something in my profile, if two users were to do the same thing with the exact same version of Nginx, they would end up with just a symlink to the exact same store path. Yeah, and in fact, I can look at my profile. Say. Yeah, so I can kind of follow this along. I accidentally changed directory. I made a mistake. I meant to. So profiles are completely separate from each other. You can, they're also using the same sort of mechanism behind the scenes where we have this sort of tree built up, symlink forest of all the different store paths that you'd want to have. Making up the software I wanted installed. In this case, a moment ago, I installed Ruby. And the same consequence where you can take your system state and roll it back or roll forward easily, then also applies to per user profiles as well. Because then, again, it's just one symlink that gets bumped. In this case, where I said relink and then this path, you'll see that my profile is pointing at this profile.58 link thing. So they're each generation, as we say, of a profile is like a numerically sequential thing. And then that link, if I were to follow it, would then point into something in the Nix store. So all I have to do is change that profile link to, say, profile-57-link or whatever. And now I've just rolled back. Yeah.
With the Nginx example, say you have two users with different versions, and within their configs, they specify different Nginx calls. Would those collide, or how's that handled?
Well, so the configuration.nix file that I showed where I had like my Nginx and Zookeeper and stuff like that set up, so that was actually reflecting the entire system. So if somebody were to log into my machine, as an example, and they had their own idea of what that configuration.nix should look like and then tried to change the state of the machine, it would actually completely clobber whatever I had and the other thing. The idea is that operates on a sort of system-wide level. I can actually, it might be interesting to see what that looks like changing configuration. Say I do not want Zookeeper running. A little bit of magic incantation saying NixOS rebuild switch. So that will take a little while, and then it'll configure my machine. Yeah. So that built-in thing that I was talking about, where you pull in multiple paths, you can kind of operate in two different ways. You can say, if I have the where there's that paths argument, you say, take all these things and glom them all together. You can run it in two ways. You can say, if there are any paths that collide, if they're the same thing that we're trying to merge into this common tree, just kind of take, I don't know, first one wins, last one wins, I don't know. But you can kind of be like, eh. You can have it just outright fail, either or. And so in the cases where something is guaranteed to work anyway, you might see it operating in this sort of manner, where it just says, there's a collision, you may want to know about that, but it's per whoever built that part of the module or package or what have you, they deemed it sort of inconsequential from the semantics sort of standpoint, like it should still work. So that's exactly what was happening. It was like, these two paths have the same name.
Yeah. If you were to go and turn the people back on, do you have it running before? Does it point to the one you had it running before, or do you get a new one pointing you back to the people running?
So if I were to go back and re-enable Zookeeper, if you look at, and I will have to admit, the UI for Nix is kind of ugly as sin right now. A big thing we want to do is make the UI like super nice. That's kind of ugly, but if you bear with it a little bit, you'll see that I'm passing as Nix packages, the tree that I want for all the modules, all the packages, all that. I have it pointing at home/source Nix packages, so my checkout. And because I'm still using that same checkout, right, I haven't changed anything in it, if I were to re-enable Zookeeper, it would be exactly as it was before. I could, however, go into that git tree and I could pull down changes from master or something like that and say Zookeeper changes, or as you remember, I said if any dependency of something changes, that bubbles up and reflects a change, then naturally you'd also see a change. Correct, and because the actual systemd unit file itself would come from, it would, if you were to look at the path, it would be completely identical. It would be the exact same store path. So you actually wouldn't have to do anything. Wouldn't have to generate any files that would already be there. It would just be a matter of identifying, just simply like that.
Yeah, you can go to 59 and go to 57?
I'm not entirely sure. I think we might still record that. But you might still have, if you're at like 57, and then at 58 I removed, and then 59 I enable again, 59 might, I think, will actually still be there, but will point to, will just point to the same thing 7 did. Yeah. Yeah, so, and it kind of hints at like, the fact that there's still some mutability going on here. I mean, we still have like a symlink in the case for my profile, and there's still like a symlink at the very root of that current system path. There's still changes happening there, but we've kind of managed to isolate all the changes to these one little like far out little places. So it's kind of minimized in a way. Everything else happens nice and declaratively, but you can't really escape the fact that if you don't change anything, well, you don't really have much of a system. Because again, you kind of want things to be installed that were installed yesterday. Where's that? Yes.
So from a maintainability standpoint, who's committed to maintaining this? And is there a clear end of life path if commitment falls off?
Well, I definitely don't think there's any concern of the latter. There are, I don't know, at least 100 or something like that, people I think that contribute quite frequently. And then we have people who are just completely prolific. There's, I think, enough interest and buy-in that is probably not going away anytime soon. If something came out that was better but maintained all the same sort of philosophy or ideology that kind of gave way to all these nice things, then I could kind of see it being out of life, but definitely not for lack of interest. But for the to answer the first half of your question, there are a handful of commercial places using it. For instance, the one that I kind of wanted to go work for a little while. And a handful of other places. I don't know if they're in really super big names. There's a company called Logic Blocks, if I got the name right, that employs Ilko Dostra, who is the person that created Nix and NixOS. It was his PhD that kind of generated all of this. And so he's employed and I believe has time allocated to of course, furthering it because they use NixOS there. But I definitely think that there could be more commercial adoption and be more money thrown at it. Right now, it's just a bunch of really passionate people that are using it for all their needs.
That's just the first question that business people are going to ask me if I say we should use this.
What's that?
I said if that's just the first question the business side is going to ask me if I say we should use this.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, we don't have like a super big commercial backing thing. So. I think that kind of boils down to, a handful of different outlooks. Depending on who you're working for or with, it may just be sort of like a hard line, like we want to know that there's somebody with a big name and with big, deep pockets and that sort of thing. But then there's also sort of a rational approach, which is like, maybe you have that, maybe we don't, but what is the sort of cost-benefit analysis? Yeah, we may need to maintain some stuff ourselves, but does it give us enough leverage that it makes sense to adopt the thing in the first place?
The mirror is configurable, right? Fundamentally, if everything went away, we could still run our own mirror. And...
For the packages, or? Right. So yeah, you could run your own Hydra instance, and there are a handful of people that do. I did for a while, and then I got tired of paying money to run the server and got distracted with other things in my life. But you can definitely run it yourself, and there are a number of people. Like individuals who run their own because they have some cash to spare and they don't want to tie up their laptop building something huge. And so what they'll do is they'll have some other build farm or just one really beefy machine and using that mechanism where you can serialize everything and say, hey, build this for me, you can offload it that way. And so, but yeah, there's no fear of having all of that entirely evaporate and having sort of no recourse. You could always run your own thing.
I got asked that question about RubyGems. So if there are afraid RubyGems is going away, they're definitely gonna be afraid this is going away.
Well, yeah, so I mean, kinda. The thing is, we have these package definitions, and ultimately they got to point at some sort of source tarball somewhere. Otherwise, it's not really much of a package. If you're worried that like the whole internet will melt down, then yeah, because you'd have to go through and. Yeah. But assuming you're not that paranoid, the whole RubyGems thing, maybe not so much. In fact, for Rails stuff, and I'll get to you in one second. For the Rails stuff. Like I said, I work on some of the infrastructure that allows you to say, here's a Rails application, I just want to like package it up like without thinking about it. We have a mirrors sort of approach in there where you can say, by default, it'll just use RubyGems or whatever. You can also override that and say, I want to use my own gem server. So even in that case, you can still say, like with a one-liner, say, yeah, use whatever gem server I have instead of the official upstream one.
If you have your version unstable, mm-hmm. and it comes out with a new version of Bash or whatever,
sure.
Is all that automated that you're like trolling the new FTP server and suddenly a new package arrives?
So package maintenance is, depending on what you're maintaining, what you're referring to specifically, some of it is just about completely automated, and then other stuff not so much. So a lot of these C libraries, not really, but I think that kind of boils down to Well, for the C stuff, I'll say that there's some sort of partial solution to that. Like we have some upstream files that can describe like where would you kind of trawl through some sort of web directory to find sequentially the like you can kind of do that thing, and you know, all you have to do is go into the directory in which the corresponding packages for say bash, and you'd run the update thing for that, and it would consult the new servers and then pull it down. But it's not really fully automated across the board, because that would kind of sort of entail that we have something nice like a universal C package management system, but we don't really have that. Different languages, you know, Ruby, pretty much everybody is consolidated or standardized on Ruby gems. And in the Haskell world, we have Hackage. So if you look at something like Haskell packages, we have just about like everything pulled down from Hackage. I don't know how much of it builds, but I think it's an astonishing amount of it. But all of the building the expressions for those things, completely automated.
Also, how much local packaging do you need to apply these, how much changes that have to be made to work under things like
this? Generally not a whole lot. So some packages, source distributions of things. Some of them are kind of designed in ways that just kind of work out of the box, and then some kind of put up a bit of a fight. A lot of the well-designed stuff will just work. You'll give a prefix for something, and it'll install it in. Something I haven't touched on is that somebody mentioned ELF. I don't know if it may have been you. There's kind of this about like how do the dynamic libraries find each other? Because a dynamic linker in a normal scenario can just look through whatever is configured, likely like user lib and some other places, and then find the corresponding, what it's looking for. You can't really have that if you don't have the one grand user lib or what have you. In every dynamic library we have, we actually set it up such that it has an R path, an explicit mentioning of like where does its dependencies live, whole path for that. I'm sorry, I lost the, I lost what the initial thing was. Did that answer your question? Close? Yeah, sorry. Yes.
I was just curious about the other pros about switching over to NixOS, because I see how it can be beneficial to SysOps QA developers and stuff like that. But for like the entry ones, I don't think they'd be up for it because the packaging is. And I was just curious because why just give a full blown OS for a great dynamic packaging tool that could be made as a solution suite for like just other flavors of
plugins. I want to make sure I completely understood that. Are you saying?
Like, I see the great feature, the packages that you demonstrate. I'm just curious, why a full-blown OS just for the great package solution when you can just make that package solution available to other flavors?
Well, so the package management part of it, you can definitely run. You can run it on Mac OS. You can run it on say Ubuntu or Fedora or any other sort of Linux or so that you. And so yeah, so you can totally run that. And again, because everything goes in the Nix store and doesn't touch any other system stuff, it's also totally safe. So if anybody here wanted just to dabble around in Nix and you're running Fedora or Red Hat or whatever, you can trivially install it and have fun with it. If you don't like it, rm-rf/nix, and then you're gone. Now, there's sort of the fact that we want to manage things like when I changed my configuration and I did NixOS rebuild to change to that configuration, right? Disabled Zookeeper, you can see that the system also manages things like stopping or reloading different units. And you can see that right here where I remove ZooKeeper and then it removed the user. And then it also did some other stuff like dbus and bulkit or whatever. So that kind of suggests that you can't really pick and choose at that level, I don't think, in any sort of reasonable way. There's just so much sort of imposition, like how many systemd units are you going to write by hand if you have to refer to some really ugly, unwieldy store path that Nix, as a whole collective thing, would have given to you. So you can definitely run Nix on its own, but then the sort of system-wide stuff kind of requires that you run NixOS. Because we have stuff like with the way my system's set up, you can set it up so you have mutable users, so you can use the typical command line tools to add or remove something, or someone, some user. I have it set up so it's immutable, and rolling forward or back ensures that the state of my users and groups are precisely what was stated. Can't ever get out of line with my configuration. Provide that sort of loophole for people that have some sort of workflow that they really want that part to be mutable. But there are a lot of things where to kind of make it all work, you just kind of have to take it all at once. You run some Linux yourself. I don't know if you do system administrative stuff or run Linux on your own machine, perhaps.
I maintain a whole like CentOS, about 20 servers that are all CentOS based. See the different version. But your answer kind of leads me to another question. Mm-hmm. So with all these different profiles being able to run different versions of different software and stuff like that, you don't need to also install or set up any type of container type of software like Docker or anything, because everyone would have their own development environment.
Yeah. So I would say yes. In many ways, it subsumes Docker. And in fact, if you kind of look at what I think is sort of the core value of Docker, is that you get at least some notion of determinism. At least you can have an image and you can have layers, so you also don't have, if things are almost identical, or you kind of layer them on top of each other, you don't pay for what should just be like the delta, right? So all of that notion of managing an image is kind of useful. Lock down the versions of things you have installed in your Docker file. But it's kind of in this sort of, because it's not sort of a holistic approach, it has this kind of problem where you don't have that sharing. If I build two Docker images fresh that don't share anything in common other than the fact that, I'm downloading all the same binaries from some apt server or whatever, or some other repo, there'll be two distinct images without a common ancestor or anything. It won't share anything. So you have 100 megs, a couple hundred megs, depending on how light your distro is. And you have no sharing there. With this notion, we have also a thing I haven't touched on called NixOS containers that use the same configuration management that you'd use on a system-wide scale. And you can say, I want to spin up a container that has this configuration. And it will use like systemd and spawn, that kind of thing. Yeah. It kind of subsumes Docker. Cool. I think that's pretty much everything I kind of want to cover, and I also kind of wanted to explore anything anybody was interested. But so that's pretty much it.
Now it's trivia time. I don't know if everybody's done this, but basically he's going to ask a question, and we're going to try to pick the first person who raises their hand and call on. Don't shout out the answer unless you're called on. And whoever gets it right can come pick a book. We have four books today. We have Linux Firewalls, Ubuntu, Shell Programming, and Go Programming. So go ahead.
All right. So there is a name for a sort of self-contained area in which you install a bunch of packages. There was a system-wide instance of this and some other stuff.
Over there in the green-gray shirt over there.
Lake Store?
So that's where the stuff goes into. But there's sort of a distinct notion.
Here?
Jailing.
Not quite.
There in the back row?
Profile?
Yes. All right, let's see here. What else can I do? What's the name of our continuous integration service?
I saw you first. Hydra.
Overly specific. What was the function that produces a symlink forest of things, respective packages? No. All right. What do we call the sort of unit of oh crap? Like I want to use the same word essentially, but slightly different. People are like gonna read his mind. Well, I could have asked that one some other time. but no, the way in which we in NixOS we kind of what do you call it? Consolidate different options and that sort of thing into this one concept.
Is there maybe some questions?
Me?
You.
Right
there. What's that? Not quite.
Attribute set? No, that would be the thing that kind of corresponds with JSON. I'm referring to, like, what is my configuration.nix called? What is it, like, a particular... case of like what's the general name for it or the zookeeper thing to describe how the zookeeper stuff works or the Nginx corresponding thing.
Nginx expression?
That is true in a very general sense. Or if I should maybe just give it away.
Module?
Yes, exactly. And all right. So what is the tool that we use to deploy?
I think you kind of had your hand up.
NixOS?
Yes.
All right, that's it.